Brought to you by Penguin.
The Mill on the Floss by George Eliot, read by Anne-Marie Duff.
Both for ease of listening and because it contains details of the plot, we've placed the introduction to this Penguin classic at the end of the audiobook.
Volume 1, Book First, Boy and Girl. Chapter 1. Outside Dorlcote Mill. A wide plain where the broadening Floss hurries on between its green banks to the sea, and the loving tide, rushing to meet it, checks its passage with an impetuous embrace. On this mighty tide the black ships, laden with the fresh-scented fir planks, with rounded sacks of oil-bearing seed, or with the dark glitter of coal, are borne along to the town of St. Ogg's, which shows its aged, fluted red roofs and the broad gables of its wharves between the low wooded hill and the river bank, tinging the water with a soft purple hue under the transient gaze of this February sun. Far away on each hand stretch the rich pastures and the patches of dark earth, made ready for the seed of broad-leaved green crops, or touched already with the tint of the tender-bladed autumn-sown corn. There is a remnant still of the last year's golden clusters of beehive ricks rising at intervals beyond the hedgerows, and everywhere the hedgerows are studded with trees. The distant ships seem to be lifting their masts and stretching their red-brown sails close among the branches of the spreading ash. Just by the red-roofed town, the tributary Ripple flows with a lively current into the Floss. How lovely the little river is with its dark, changing wavelets. It seems to me like a living companion while I wander along the bank and listen to its low, placid voice, as to the voice of one who is deaf and loving. I remember those large, dipping willows. I remember the stone bridge. And this is Dorlcote Mill. I must stand a minute or two here on the bridge and look at it, though the clouds are threatening, and it is far on in the afternoon. Even in this leafless time of departing February, it is pleasant to look at. Perhaps the chill, damp season adds a charm to the trimly kept, comfortable dwelling house, as old as the elms and chestnuts that shelter it from the northern blast. The stream is brim full now, and lies high in this little withy plantation, and half drowns the grassy fringe of the croft in front of the house. As I look at the full stream, the vivid grass, the delicate bright green powder softening the outline of the great trunks and branches that gleam from under the bare purple boughs, I am in love with moistness, and envy the white ducks that are dipping their heads far into the water here among the withes, unmindful of the awkward appearance they make in the drier world above. The rush of the water and the booming of the mill bring a dreamy deafness which seems to heighten the peacefulness of the scene. They are like a great curtain of sound, shutting one out from the world beyond. And now there is the thunder of the huge covered wagon coming home with sacks of grain. That honest wagoner is thinking of his dinner, getting sadly dry in the oven at this late hour, but he will not touch it till he has fed his horses. The strong, submissive, meek-eyed beasts, who, I fancy, are looking mild reproach at him from between their blinkers, that he should crack his whip at them in that awful manner, as if they needed that hint. See how they stretch their shoulders up the slope towards the bridge with all the more energy because they are so near home. Look at their grand shaggy feet that seem to grasp the firm earth, at the patient strength of their necks bowed under the heavy collar, at the mighty muscles of their struggling haunches. I should like well to hear them neigh over their hardly earned feed of corn, and see them, with their moist necks freed from the harness, dipping their eager nostrils into the muddy pond. Now they are on the bridge, and down they go again at a swifter pace, and the arch of the covered wagon disappears at the turning behind the trees. Now I can turn my eyes towards the mill again, and watch the unresting wheel sending out its diamond jets of water. That little girl is watching it too. She has been standing on just the same spot at the edge of the water ever since I paused on the bridge, and that queer white cur with the brown ear seems to be leaping and barking in ineffectual remonstrance with the wheel, Perhaps he is jealous because his playfellow in the beaver bonnet is so rapt in its movement. It is time the little playfellow went in, I think, and there is a very bright fire to tempt her. The red light shines out under the deepening grey of the sky. It is time, too, for me to leave off resting my arms on the cold stone of this bridge. Oh, my arms are really benumbed. I have been pressing my elbows on the arms of my chair and dreaming that I was standing on the bridge in front of Dorlcote Mill as it looked one February afternoon many years ago. Before I dozed off, I was going to tell you what Mr. and Mrs. Tulliver were talking about as they sat by the bright fire in the left-hand parlour on that very afternoon I have been dreaming of. Chapter 2. Mr. Tulliver of Dorlcote Mill declares his resolution about Tom.
"What I want, you know," said Mr. Tulliver, "what I want is to give Tom a good education, an education as'll be a bread to him. That's what I was thinking on when I gave notice for him to leave the academy at Lady Day. I mean to put him to a downright good school at Midsummer. The 2 years at the academy had a done well enough if I'd meant to make a miller and farmer of him, for he's had a fine sight more schooling nor I ever got. All the learning my father ever paid for was a bit of birch at one end and the alphabet at t'other. But I should like Tom to be a bit of a scholard, so as he might be up to the tricks of those fellows as talk fine and right way or flourish. It'd be a help to me with these lawsuits and arbitrations and things. I wouldn't make a downright lawyer of the lad. I should be sorry for him to be a rascal, but a sort of engineer or a surveyor or an auctioneer and valuer, like Riley, or one of them smartish businesses as are all profits and no outlay, only for a big watch chain and a high stool. They're pretty nigh all one, and they're not far off being even with the law, I believe. For Riley looks Lawyer Wakeham in the face as hard as one cat looks another. He's none frightened at him."
Mr. Tulliver was speaking to his wife, a blonde, comely woman in a fan-shaped cap. I'm afraid to think how long it is since fan-shaped caps were worn. They must be so near coming in again. At that time, when Mrs. Tulliver was nearly 40, they were new at St. Ogg's and considered sweet things.
"Well, Mr. Tulliver, you know best. I've no objections. But hadn't I better kill a couple of fowl and have aunts and uncles to dinner next week, so as you may hear what Sister Glegg and Sister Pullet have got to say about it? There's a couple of fowl wants killing."
"You may kill every fowl in the yard if you like, Bessie, but I shall ask neither aunt nor uncle what I'm to do with me own lad," said Mr. Tulliver defiantly.
"Dear heart," said Mrs. Tulliver, shocked at this sanguinary rhetoric. "How can you talk so, Mr. Tulliver? But it's your way to speak disrespectful of my family, and Sister Glegg throws all the blame upon me, though I'm sure I'm as innocent as the babe unborn, for nobody ever heard me say as it wasn't lucky for my children to have aunts and uncles as can live independent. However, if Tom's to go to a new school, I should like him to go where I can wash him and mend him. Else he might as well have calico as linen, for they'd be one as yellow as the other before they'd been washed half a dozen times. And then, when the box is going backwards and forwards, I could send the lad a cake or a pork pie or an apple, for he can do with an extra bit, bless him, whether they stint him at the meals or no. My children can eat as much victuals as most, thank God.
Well, we won't send him out of reach of the carrier's cart if other things fit in," said Mr. Tulliver. "But you mustn't put a spoke in the wheel about the washing if we can't get to school near enough. That's the fault I have to find with you, Bessie. If you see a stick in the road, you're allus thinking you can't step over it. You'd want me not to hire a good waggoner, because he'd got a mole on his face."
"Dear heart," said Mrs. Tulliver in mild surprise. "When did I ever make objections to a man because he'd got a mole on his face? I'm sure I'm rather fond of the moles, for my brother, as is dead and gone, had a mole on his brow. But I can't remember your ever offering to hire a waggoner with a mole, Mr. Tulliver. There was John Gibbs hadn't a mole on his face, no more than you have. And I was all for having you hire him. And so you did hire him, and if he hadn't died of the inflammation, as we paid Dr. Turnbull for attending him, he'd very likely have been driving the wagon now. He might have a mole somewhere out of sight, but how was I to know that, Mr. Tulliver?"
No, Bessie, I didn't mean justly the mole.
I meant it to stand for something else, but never mind. It's puzzling work, talking is. What I'm thinking on is how to find the right sort of school to send Tom to, for I might be taying in again, as I've been with Academy. I'll have nothing to do with Academy again. Whatever school I send Tom to, it shan't be Academy. It shall be a place where the lads spend their time.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.